What was that point where you realized I've been going at a pace that's been nonstop? I need to take a break.
So it was a bit like a few weeks ago. I was just really overwhelmed, and I just was, I don't know, I was just unhappy. I couldn't concentrate on anything, right? Like, I feel like, you remember, you ever see this clip on I Love Lucy or something, and it's like a conveyor belt, right? It's an old clip from like the 50s. There's like a conveyor belt. And all they have to do, they have to take something from the conveyor belt and they have to move it over here. But eventually everything on the conveyor belt, it starts piling up and it starts to fall out, spill out of the edges, and it starts to block up and they go crazy and they can't do anything. That's what it feels like for me. It's just everything is piling up and it's spilling. And what can I do? I can't do anything. Like, okay, right now, I'm good now. I'm doing very good now. Because I realize it's also about your timetable, right? Because I know that this semester, for the next 5 months, I don't have to go back to class, and I don't have deadlines, and I don't have XYZ. So it's just the relief of knowing, not even necessarily right now, right? I had work to do in the summer, but when I realized that I had that time afterwards, then I started to relax more. Because what really causes you the stress is when you aren't stopping and you know that there's more ahead and you still can't stop. You know what I mean?
Could you say that part again?
It's like when you, let's say you are really getting at something. When you know that there is so much more ahead, right? And there is so much more time that you have to work at that intensity for. For example, let's say you have a month where you have to really grind. If after that month, you know that you can chill out, just kind of like final season or something, it's not as bad. But if you know you have to grind for that month and you have 5 more months ahead where you still have to do the same thing, you're going to just give in that month. You're going to get defeated because you know that I have to last not only this month, I have to last these next couple of months and stay at this intensity. And I'm already burned up.
Wow.
Know what I mean?
I do.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great thing that you're sharing there. The way you're sharing it makes me think that I guess it highlights the importance of taking breaks more because it's something to look forward to so that you can recharge.
I think what people these days, well, not just these days, it's just that some people, they work so much that they don't look forward to the breaks because they don't even know, they don't enjoy their breaks because they don't know what to do. They don't do anything enjoyable. They either kind of just go on their phones, fill in their time. They don't have hobbies that they enjoy because they haven't had the time even to explore that.
Yeah. I was thinking for myself recently that there's hobbies that I have that I haven't been enjoying doing them in a long time. But then recently, I started enjoying a particular hobby again. And I was like, wow, so this is what it feels like to have hobbies. This is what it feels like to fill up your free time, to fill up that break with something useful.
It's just you, it's a matter of, a lot of the time we lose our, like when we are working so hard, we completely lose our, we lose who we are. So what I do, I keep notes in my phone about what I like to do because you forget, you genuinely forget. And when you're done with the work, you're just like, what do I do now? What is next for me? I have a list, man, of things I can do for fun. Like, yeah, that's right. And I can do that. I remember I used to, before this, I used to do that for fun. And I think I really highlight the importance of, I mean, this is just for me, of having like a second brain, right? I keep a second brain on my phone. All of the things that I don't want to have to, have myself to remember all the time, every single time. For example, right? Maybe, sometimes you are going through something and there's a few things that can comfort you. Maybe they are just phrases. Maybe they are verses from the Quran. Maybe they are XYZ. But if you have to remember all of those things, it's going to take so much mental energy. If you keep it on your phone, cataloged somewhere, all you do when you feel something, you take a look at it. And it makes you feel better instantly. And it's right there. And that goes for pretty much, right? Your goals, anything, right? What are your long-term goals? You don't want to keep all of them up here. It's going to be too much. It's going to tax your energy for what? Keep it on your phone. You lose track of where you are going. You lose track of who you are. You go back to that, those notes, whatever notes you have.
Yeah. There's some people I meet and they strike me as poets. You strike me as someone with the streak of a poet in your soul. Would you agree?
Yes. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Do you have a favorite line of poetry?
This is an Arabic line of poetry. I don't know who wrote it. It says, "Perhaps the affliction that you hate will lead you to a destiny that you never dreamed of."
What is the Arabic?
It's in classical Arabic. So I'd have to pull it up for you. I wouldn't want to waste your time. It would take a while.
Okay,
But
no worries.
I mean that's I mean I found that right as I have grown older, that how true that is, that every calamity opens a door for you. It opens 10 doors. And you may not realize it in the moment because of course, the emotion and you are processing it and how much it bears on you. But you don't know how 1 year later, how the course of your life will be 1 year later because of this. And so much so that you will be thankful that XYZ happened to you, that you were afflicted with XYZ. And it's so tough to kind of admit, like, I went through all of that pain and it was good for me. But it's something good to have because some people they feel that they feel pain for nothing. And of course in Islam that we know that none of it is for nothing. It all has a good purpose in our lives. So there's multiple levels
Yes.
to it in my mind, right? That there's a divine decree of Allah. We have destiny. We have everything that happens to us is good, whether it is for our destiny or whether it is good for to expiate our sins, or perhaps whether it is good for our development. And then you have another level, where is that it might guide you to something better than, Allah knows better for you than what you know for yourself, right? Perhaps you hate a thing, but it is good for you, and perhaps you love a thing, but it is bad for you.
It's a really life-changing thing when you adopt that view. I noticed for myself especially that when you recognize, hey, there's reason in this pain, like Allah knows better than I do, it really changes things for you. You were talking about having a second brain, cataloging certain things on your phone. I wonder, do you have a second brain or a second heart, maybe, for your emotions? How do you deal
Of
with
course.
those?
Of course. I think, for me, I actually keep I think Instagram for most things is bad in my opinion, but I have a good use for it. And I keep actually a In my saved, I keep a collection of Islamic reminders, Quranic verses, and hadith that comfort me. And this is a very long list. And when you are struck with calamity, it's so hard to remember each and every one of those things. You can't. It takes so much mental energy to bring it back up. So I keep a catalog of those. And every time I read one, comforts me even more. Comforts in the present, makes me not worryful for the future. I know that the affliction will leave me, and it has so many other different comforts and benefits, and it makes you realize that there really is nothing. People, they turn to all sorts of comforts in this world. Even people, right? People are here to comfort us. But in the end, sometimes there comes affliction, or there comes a point where there's nobody who can help you except Allah. So you, people, they cannot give you any advice, and you cannot do anything for yourself. But you can go to the prayer mat, and instantly you feel the relief. Or you go to the Quran and you feel the relief, or you read the ahadith, which are divinely guided, right? Even though it's the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying it, right? What does it say in the Quran? That the Prophet does not speak of his own accord or like by his own desire. It is all divinely guided from Allah. So all of this advice and all of this wisdom, it all comes from Allah. So He's the only one who could bring you wisdom that is sufficient to comfort you.
Yeah, that's really quite the phenomenon, as you mentioned, especially that there comes a point where even people can't give you advice, but you can go to the mat. I can recall certain instances like that where, wow, it's as if nothing could have saved me but a prayer, kind of a thing, you know?
Yeah.
You had said something to me one time. I remember I was sharing with you that I felt kind of guilty because of all the havoc going on in the world and feeling like I'm not doing enough. So I asked you, I said, how do you deal with the guilt? And you said instantly, you show up. You mind
Yeah.
explaining that a little?
Often, people, we look for output goals in that we want to achieve a certain thing, but many times it is out of our control. Now, with personal goals, this is relatively easy, right? You say you want to hit so and so on bench press. This is achievable. But something like freeing Palestine, this is something that is directly out of our hands, as in we cannot make the direct decision. So we have to do our best to influence it. So we have our input goals in that we will do our best to put in the effort, but we cannot feel guilty. We cannot make a desired out. We cannot be guilty if the desired outcome is different, because this is not in our hands. We can only do our best to show up and to commit our time, to commit our souls to free to trying to help these people. And after that, that's it. Because this is a marathon. This is a lifelong commitment, lifelong journey. If you just spend your entire life feeling guilty all the time, this is not going to benefit you. The only way it can benefit you is if it pushes you to do more. But of course, this is up to a certain extent. You can only do so much. You just have to do your best and plan for, and basically until the end of your life. I will be doing this until I die. And if you're always burned out emotionally, you're just not, even the most dedicated of people, they're not going to last.
I like how you mentioned that because what I wanted to ask you was in the context of this movement, earlier you said, hey, if you have to grind for a month and then you know it's just this month, after this, it's a break, you'll be fine. But if you have to grind this month and you know, hey, there's 5 more months ahead of me that I have to grind, there's a chance that you'll probably burn out, you'll give up. With a movement like this, especially, I feel like it's one of those things where, as you said, it's a marathon. It's like a life marathon. So you can grind it out. You can put in your best for this month, but there's all these months ahead of you that you have to keep doing it. So in the context of this movement, what do you think about taking breaks and I guess resting and I don't know, like still, I guess showing up or maybe not showing up. What do you think?
This is, well, this is something different than study. It's different than personal goals. This is for something far more serious and far more, it's far bigger than ourselves. So I think that you don't have to be in a constant grind, because in the end, you will, even if people are dying, man, you will burn out. It's just you cannot, mentally, you cannot do anymore. So I believe in having it be, again, a marathon. A moderate, like, I'm thinking, sub 4 hour or 2 hour marathon. I think under 2 hour. Like, run that marathon, but make sure it is intense, right? Because every single piece of effort that we put in, it could save somebody's mother, or save somebody's daughter, or save someone, any one person, right? Maybe they are just a number on the screen to most people, but to somebody else, this is somebody crying for their son, a mother crying for her son, a father crying for his daughter. In the end, if we burn out, we cannot help them, because people, they will step away. They'll say, man, I'm tired of this. I'm gonna take a few months off. I'm gonna take years off. They'll just leave it completely because of how burned out they are. But if you just keep it at a moderate pace, I'm a firm believer that you don't really, it's very hard to kind of leave, because emotionally you're still attached, but you have enough in you to just keep going. You're tired, but you're not pushing yourself to the extent that you want to leave. You want to keep going. And that's what I believe now. Because a few months ago, right, last semester, it was just all the time, all the time, all the time. And I was like, after I was done, I was like, man, I can't, I don't want to do this for a while. And that's not good. Now, I'm taking it at a moderate pace, and I'm just saying, hey, I'm not going to stop now. As long as I keep it like this, I'm not going to stop.
Yeah. That sounds like a really healthy answer.
Thank you.
So what else has been going on, man?
Not really much, just kind of this semester I kind of found my peace. I
You
want to
seem really
protect it.
peaceful. Yeah.
Yeah. Just kind of chill. Not really worried about anything. Not stressed about anything. Just kind of hanging out, studying. I'm studying on my own. I'm studying from, and take some placement exams. It's for like biology, get some credit. I don't want to take it in like a class. It's going to take up too much time, too much. Like, I could literally study for like 2 or 3 weeks and pass the exam and just get the credit instead of like grinding in class, because that's going to go on my transcript. If I'm lazy in class, it's going to be on my transcript. It's not going to look good. But, a placement exam, no one cares if you got like a 60.
Do you tend to make friends in your classes, or
No,
is it more
never.
like you just
Never. I
you
made
just
one friend in my class. I've been in university for 2 years. I have made one friend in all of my classes that I still talk to.
Wow.
Yeah.
And you're cool with that. You're cool with just, hey, come to class, I do my work, and I leave.
Yeah, because extracurriculars is where you make all the friends, man. And also, last semester I didn't go to class, like, to be honest. I didn't have it wasn't mandatory for any of my classes, so I just didn't go. That's not good. This next semester I want to go, because I changed my major, actually. So I was doing history before, but four of my professors left the university kind of miraculously. Two of them retired, two of them went to another university. So I was like, you know what, I'm just gonna like finish off my major with stuff like that I'm not that interested in. I'm interested in everything, but it's not gonna benefit, the knowledge isn't gonna benefit me as much. So I said, you know what, let me change to political science while I still can. So actually I'm looking forward to that next semester.
It sounds exciting.
Yeah, man, there's some. I got the list of classes right here. It's just kind of waiting for me, just so I can see, like, okay, before you take something, right? You always want to see if you're interested in the classes, obviously, if the professors are good. So I looked up all the professors on Rate My Professor. Seemed decent. So I'm happy with the decision. Something new to look forward to.
Yeah. That sounds cool. I was reflecting on something yesterday. I was talking to an older man, and it was chill. We were just having a good time talking. And it made me think, I've noticed this pattern in my life before where there'll be like certain people where I'll vibe with them and we'll have like a good conversation and whatnot. But I won't be friends with their kids or their grandkids. Like, we just won't vibe. But it's like, wow, that older person, we vibed. It was a good conversation. That's just something that I was thinking about. Like, man, like there's specifically this there was this one guy, he passed away, he was my friend. He was my friend, but I never got along with his son. Or his grandkids. Like, no beef, but I just never got along with them. But he was my friend. Isn't that interesting? All the random people you become friends with.
Well, we spend our formative years in different places. So, your friend, he spent his young years different than his son and his grandson. All of them completely different lives. And also his son is one half, is only half of your friend, right? The other half is his mother. And for his grandkids, it's only like a quarter your friend of his, genetics and such. So, I mean, hey, every person is so unique, and your friend is he's just he doesn't have to be like his son. That's what people don't really think about, is that your kids, like people, they expect their kids to be like them. How do you know? They might pick up a few traits from you, a few core traits, but in the end, they're going to grow up completely different than you, and they are a completely different person than you. Period. They're going to be different.
Yeah. That phenomenon to me is just so fascinating.
I don't expect, I expect my kids, hope my kids are better than me.
Yeah. Dude, we're coming to the last 10 minutes of this podcast.
All right.
What are the things you wanted to get off your chest? What are the things you wanted to talk about?
I really wanted to talk about, I don't know. I want to talk about Islam. But I don't know where to really, I don't know, start off on.
Well, I saw him the other day, last week.
Your friend.
Yeah,
You
Islam.
Muslim? Oh, Islam. Oh. Well,
No,
different Islam than
I'm
I was
kidding. I'm
referring to.
kidding. I'm
No,
kidding. Yeah.
I know, I know.
Okay.
Maybe you could
Yeah.
pull, maybe you could start something from the.
Well, I guess I could. There's this book I've been reading these days. It's called Prayers of the Pious by Omar Suleiman and there
Okay.
was this there's one yesterday that I was reading, or the other day. It's here's the prayer. O Allah, I ask you for faith that does not unravel and delight that never depletes, and the companionship of your Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, in the highest eternal garden. And the reason I love this prayer so much is because one of the things, especially about faith, that I often contend with is it fluctuates, and when it fluctuates, when it's low, what you really need to have is patience. But the thing about patience, especially in this world, is it can run very thin. It's a very rare thing to have. So when your faith is fluctuating, when it's low, and your patience is very thin, what do? How do you contend with that? And so the reason I love that prayer especially is because I ask you for faith that doesn't deplete. It's very powerful words.
You know, one of the things about patience is that, you know, some people say, you know, how can I be patient when patience is one of the most difficult things, right? It's like how do you know you will last? And I saw something and it says like just how you know that eventually during Ramadan, the Maghrib Adhan will be called. Like you are starving, but you know for sure that you are going to eat later. You're going to eat eventually, right? Inshallah, right? That you are still alive by that time, but you know you're going to eat. You know that eventually you'll get your relief, and you have to have a similar level of faith with your patience and patience related to faith as well. Because even though your iman might be low, right? You have to believe that, you have to have sabr and believe that, hey, I will get my iman back to where it was before. And you will have to do that through doing extra worship, right? You have to soften your heart. You have to pray more. You have to do more dhikr. You have to read more Quran. And, you know, we have busy lives and we have limited mental energy. So this takes more, right? Because sometimes, man, you don't want to do these things because you're tired. This is natural for us humans, right? You don't want to force yourself to do extra acts of worship beyond the mandatory. But I think that when you start to realize that your iman is getting low, I think you have to just put in that effort. And you can't just say, oh, I'm tired, right? I don't feel like doing this. You have to have sabr is it applies to so many things. Right, one of sabr is not just waiting. Another prong of sabr that the scholars have discussed is bearing through something, putting in energy to push through something. So when your iman is low, you have to put in that effort and push through, and have patience that eventually, right, your heart it will open up.
Wow. That was amazing what you said. And towards the beginning, that word, eventually, that's the word,
Exactly.
eventually. I also like how you said prong. That was a good bit of language you used there. Another prong.
That was language used by Imam Mahed when he explained it to us.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah, there's something I was telling Sheikhani one time, which was I remember there was this MSA iftar this one time in Ramadan, and I had the date in my hand, and they're passing them out to people. And so the azan was going off, like someone was calling it, but I was looking around to see if like people were eating. And then it hit me in that moment, like, wait, what am I doing? The azan's being called. It's time to eat the day. So it's like it's interesting where it's time to eat, but I'm still looking at other people. Like, hey, are they opening it yet? To get like that sort of like confirmation. It's like, no. The confirmation is already here to the azan. It's time for you to move. Yeah.
Where should we go from there? What are you thinking of? Like, what else can you relate to that?
About that specific story or just patience in general?
Just that, like, no, what you mentioned about, like, you're looking around for confirmation, but the confirmation is in front of you. You don't need other people to
Yeah.
confirm it for you.
Well, I remember specifically that train of thought. I was trying to get at something like everyone has their own appointed time set by Allah about certain things. You don't need to necessarily look at other people to see, hey, is it right for me? It's, hey, wait, the azan, like the beacon of truth is going off. That's the only confirmation I need, so to
Okay.
speak. Something like that. Yeah. But the idea is very much, not looking at other people and comparing yourself. It's like, hey, it's time. Do your thing.
No, I think that you can relate that to, right, you're receiving your rizq, receiving your sustenance from Allah. That we look around at people and we're like, okay, this guy he is 23. This guy he is 21. This guy he is 24. He is married, he is rich, he is blah blah blah. and you're looking around, you're like, okay, I am 23 or 24 or whatever have you, and I still have not received so and so. I still have not gotten married, or I still have not gotten a career, or gotten a what's called, hey, you haven't reached this goal, certain goal. And I think that the confirmation, right, that you don't have to look at other people. You know that you will get these things because this is a promise from Allah. May not be in this life, may not be in this life. That's one of the things, right? As long as you make dua and you make it within the proper guidelines, it will be accepted, right? According to the hadith, right? There's three different ways your dua could be accepted. Either you get it, you get something, you get it later, or something in its place that is equivalent, or it is denied and it is stored for you in the hereafter on the day of judgment. On and it is going to add on to your good deeds. So you don't need to look around to know that you are getting these things. You know that Allah is going to give you.
Yeah. And that word again, eventually. Eventually. Yeah. Dude, one of the things I wanted to close off with was you dress really nicely. In just a short set of words, why is that the case?
I feel good.
Awesome. You feel good. Yeah. Well, man, we're coming to a close. If you have any closing thoughts in a minute, you can give it to me. But otherwise, it's been wonderful talking to you.
It's been
You
great to
dropped some
talk to you too.
gems.
Oh, thank you,
You
brother.
really did.
You're a good interviewer,
Ah,
podcaster.
interviewer.
Really nice. You have a nice cadence. You know how to say something to like leave it open-ended. You know, like when you ask a question, you do a good job of asking questions.
Alhamdulillah. I hope so, man.
Alhamdulillah.
So, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, brother.
But I suppose until next time, eh? Inshallah.
So next time, let's do this soon, inshallah.
Yes, sir. Take care.
All righty. Assalamu alaikum.